going to take things a little bit out of order tonight. We're going to start with the release of the lot at 67 Old Farm Road. And so you're here for this one? All right. Julie, any opening comments you want to give on that?
It's something that should have happened a long time ago, but didn't. And now, as I understand it, the homeowner is having trouble selling the lot because technically all the paperwork's not in order. So this is just a formality.
Gotcha. Anything you'd like to add? Any questions or concerns from the board?
No, it's really old.
Yeah. All right. Do we have a motion?
Okay, let me find the title here.
Last and through.
I don't.
This one? Is that what you're looking for?
We don't have any paperwork on it. It's
no.
Just, oh, okay.
Yeah, it was just electronic.
Yeah.
Move that the CPDC approve the release of lot 67, or the lot at 67 Old Farm Road.
Second.
All those in favor? All right.
We're done.
So I'll send a copy to Donna tomorrow. Yeah, sure.
Julie, just stamp with this?
Yeah, just stamp it.
Cool.
We started with an easy one that only did three of us, so we did the release.
Yeah. All right. So next up is the special permit for the animal kennel at 271 Main Street. Is anyone here for that? Brad, you are? Okay. Julie, any opening comments on this one?
I'll let Brad.
Okay. Yeah, please.
This is really concerning a special permit of the zoning bylaw to allow what has been existing to exist. It's existed for over 30 years as a animal care and a kennel facility. They have had a license issued by the Board of Health for years under that provision of the law. And it turns out, of course, that because of the zoning bylaw, they need a special permit to operate this facility as a tenant. The Chief of Staff with me this evening, who's one of the principals of the facility. I'd like to, if I could, quickly go through, and I know this is in the supplemental information we provided, but just work through the 12 points of special permit really quickly. First, it must be a suitable location for this submit that is a suitable location being in the business A zoning district. Commercial use on both sides and across the street of it. And there'll be no change physically in what's being proposed, just the legalization of that which existed for many years. Item number two must be compatible with existing uses. Again, there's commercial use on both sides and across the street. It's a very quiet use, contrary to what one might think, but in actuality, it's quiet. Behind there is a large wooded area, and the dwellings that are behind there are over 500 feet away on the other side of the forested area. And number three, it will not constitute a nuisance to the air and water pollution, flood, noise, or dust. There's no pollution generated by this. The fecal matter is put into dumpsters and removed by a professional waste management company. In fact, customers are surprised by how quiet the operation is. There's no discharge of polluted water into the watershed. Property is tied to municipal water and sewer service. Premises are kept clean. All things pest control company comes monthly for pest control activities. It does have the appearance of a single family dwelling. It does have a 6-foot fence around the activity area to screen that from the public. Item number four will not be substantial inconvenience or hazard to abutters, vehicles or pedestrians. There is no hazard or consequence of this. Main Street is a straightaway. There's good visible, good sight distance for vehicles entering and exiting the site. They do not cater to pedestrians and there's no pedestrian element to this. It is an appropriate facility or location for this use. Item number six, use for protection against possible detrimental or offensive use of the site. Again, I talked about the fencing that exists. The clean use takes place there, the management is strong in that regard. number seven, with reference to sign regulations, no changes are proposed in the existing signage. Item number eight, the convenient, safe vehicle and pedestrian, where we describe the accessibility, there's adequate parking areas and adequate reviews in that regard. Item number nine talks about off-street loading and unloading of vehicles. There are no commercial vehicles that come there, they go out and pick up supplies themselves in their own vehicles and come back. So the question that the no requirement of loading for this, it's worked well without having it. Number 10, adequate method of disposal and storage for sewage refuse or waste. And that's tied to municipal water and sewer, the requirement of collection facility for the trash and the matter. Protection from flood hazards, there's been no flood bombs or sites of consequence. And number 12, the last one, protection of water quality when public and private supplies. There's been no difficulty as far as the runoff from the site. I'd like to address one point. If you wanted to wait, I know the draft decision's been served related. I can wait till you get to that. If you want to, give one comment on one.
Yeah, let's wait 1 second.
Thank you.
Any questions on this from the board?
Not on the use. There is a, there's at least one spotlight on the northwest corner of the building that's sort of facing the roadway. It's well above the fence line. So if you're coming south at night, that spot is right in the driver's eyes. I would suggest trying to point it down a little more. I haven't driven by it in probably a couple of weeks, but.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, we just try pointing it down a little bit. The only thing I noticed, that's the only thing I ever noticed about the building. It's a quiet use.
Looking at the, I'm kind of jumping to the conditions now. And it goes back to a point you made, Brad. So there's no deliveries that are made there? Is that how I understand
it? No, they go out and get their own supplies with their employees and bring them back.
Okay. And we've got a condition in here for that. No deliveries shall be made to the site.
That's fine. There'll be no commercial deliveries.
But why do we? I don't like that condition.
I
would word it as potentially no delivery shall be made on Main Street or on 28th, but don't they have a driveway that goes around back?
Mm-hmm.
So couldn't
they
just take the truck back there?
Yeah,
it's kind of a weird condition for a business to.
Yeah,
rather
have
it like that. But no delivery shall be made to the site from Main Street or something. Or delivery vehicle shall not park on Main Street.
Okay with that?
Yeah.
Looks like they changed the date then.
Yeah.
I'll change the date.
And there's a note here about the first condition, whether or not the board thinks we should keep this.
I put it in there because in my experience, when a special permit changes hands, it's often good to make sure that the next owners understand the conditions of the permit and just come in and have a conversation about the use.
Sure.
But it's up to you if you want to keep it or not.
And I've got no problem with it.
Mm-hmm. That could be handled administratively next time if there's no changes.
It could be.
That's the one condition we can speak to. We believe the special permit requires certain physical characteristics of the site which do exist and are not changing. If there's any effort to change that, irrespective of ownership, they have to come back to you and change the special permit. In addition, this is a site licensed by the Board of Health, so any kind of detrimental use of the site has a risk of running the revocation of that license, which would be made. So our request was that condition not to have that.
Borrow this for a second. I can't find it.
What are thoughts on removing it? And I don't see it being too onerous, but I don't necessarily tied to it.
Yeah, I don't have a problem either way. It does have to go through Board of Health.
No.
Okay, you're talking about condition one, the transfer?
Yeah.
It was my understanding that the special permit almost by definition cannot transfer with the property.
It it does run with the property, and the question is whether the CPDC wants to impose a condition, which it can. Relate to that, but my suggestion is that the change of ownership is not a significant change that should warrant a special permit that runs with the land. They have to come back.
Special permit run with the land or with the use?
I'm sorry?
Does the special permit run with the land or
it
the
does.
Use?
It runs with the land. On a zoning special permit.
Are we sure about this?
I didn't think we granted special permits for land use. Thought that was ZBA's jurisdiction.
The zoning special permit does run with the land, it runs with the property, and it relates to the conditions and use of the property. So if those change, that requires a change of the special permit. But the change of ownership does not end up in the revocation of the special permit. The statute does allow you to put this
right.
language in there, so you could limit it to the ownership. So I'm not challenging that right. We're saying under the circumstances, we don't think it's necessary to have some.
And these are the new owners. These are the.
I think
existing.
This is existing. So, but I thought the reason for doing this was so they could sell the property. Sell the.
I'm sorry.
I thought that the reason for getting this cleared up was so that they could sell or transfer ownership.
That's correct.
So that means that the next, if they sell it next month, they have to come right back in, which seems silly.
Yeah.
So I would vote to take it out.
Okay.
That's fine.
Just condition two automatically has the next owners coming in to apply for kennel license. And they can be made aware of all of this.
Yeah.
This is the special permit.
Okay, so we're gonna remove condition one. We've revised condition seven. And Brad, that condition one was the one you had a question on?
Yes, sir.
Or comment? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Good. Any other questions or comments?
Nope.
Anyone in the audience have any questions or comments on this one? All right.
Move that the CPDC approve the special permit for the animal kennel at 271 Main Street, Pet Companions Incorporated, as amended.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? All right.
Okay.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Is there anything we need?
See the outline of the old clock.
Can we start this?
The wall.
Is this next one a public hearing?
Yes.
Do we have the notice in here?
I do.
So next up on our agenda is going to be the definitive subdivision, Lyle Estates at 364 Lowell Street.
Yep.
All right. Well, we'll start with the public notice.
Notice is hereby given that under MGL Chapter 41, Section 81T and Section 6.2.1 of the Reading Subdivision Rules and Regulations, the Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, June 20th. 2016 at 7:45 in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to consider the application for a definitive subdivision submitted by Jameson Properties, LLC, for the property located at 364 Lowell Street, Assessor's Map 26, Lot 157. A copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in Public Services Office in Town Hall, Monday through Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m.
All right, great. So this is a public hearing. How we're going to handle it is we're going to have town staff provide a brief overview on it. I assume the applicants up here, give them an opportunity to present it. The board will discuss and deliberate, and then we'll open it up to any public comments, and then we'll close the public hearing. However, I don't think we're going to end up closing it tonight. There still are a lot of questions that I think our engineering department is going to need to address with all of you. So I know we've allocated an hour and 15 minutes. I'd really not like to use an hour and 15 minutes for this because we're going to have to come back and talk about this again in a subsequent meeting. But let's start the discussion, and Julie, I'll ask you to provide a brief overview.
Sure. So the application before you is for a 4-lot subdivision off of Lowell Street. It's as you go towards the interchange with 129. It's on the left-hand side. The site is heavily constrained by wetlands, as you can see on the plan on the screen. But the 4 lots that are proposed do comply with the S15 zoning district, with the exception of if they move the frontage for the existing house to the new subdivision road, they will need to get a variance from the zoning board. So, sum it up.
All right, yeah, please.
Members of the commission, good evening. I'm William Crowley, I'm an attorney, and I have an office at 159 Haven Street. With me is David Jamieson and Thad Berry, who's our engineer. I want to give a brief introduction of the Jamieson family and a brief history of the title on the property, and then we can seg into our proposal. And on the specifics, I will defer to our engineer, who can answer questions, I'm sure, way better than I can. The Jamieson family has been in the real estate business since 1969. It was started by David's parents, and they still are very active in building and owning and renting and developing first-class quality housing. Now the business is primarily run by David and his 3 brothers, but his parents are still very much involved. It is a family-run business, great family. They build quality homes, and they pay attention to detail. They care about the community, and they care about the quality of the product that they build. The lot itself is interesting. This property actually, as I went back through the back chain of title, was owned over 100 years ago by Cyrus Barrows, who was the father of the person whose school we have named Alice Barrows. This was her father. And Cyrus owned huge tracts of land, in this case, on the westerly side of Grove Street and on both sides of Lowell Street. And over the years, he subdivided and sold off other large parcels. And this is one of those large parcels which had been subdivided again and again. Now, there were paper plans that had been recorded back in the 1920s, which showed certain roads that might have gone in had it been developed way back then. And those roads obviously weren't put in, except Dustin Road, Plymouth Road. Those are there, but there's a question from engineering, what do we do with the paper streets that are showing up on the old plans? And it's really not an issue because this is the last remaining original piece of the parcel. There are no reservations in the back chain of title for the deeds to the contiguous properties. Some of the paper streets kind of go up and would ultimately cut right through the existing houses on Dustin Road. So, especially since there is no reservation contained in the old deeds, nor in the original deed to our property, it's really not an issue. So this, any plan which is approved supersedes those old paper. The streets were never accepted by the town in any event. The original house, which is still on Lowell Street, Julie had mentioned that if one of the considerations was to change the front door to the new street, which would be called Lyle Estates. And I'll tell you why. Lyle Estates, and I forgot a piece to the history of the property. Cyrus Barrow sold the property in the 1920s, and it was then subsequently sold within a year or two after that to the Lyle family in 1925. It has been, had been in the Lyle family until 2013, when the Jamesons purchased this property. It consists now of a little over 2.5 acres of land. What's interesting, and unfortunately the Jamesons have to live with this, is along this easterly border, which is the back property line of the houses on Plymouth Road, is an old drainage ditch which our town put in over 100 years ago. There's a catch basin in Lowell Street, and it just dumps all the water right out into this drainage ditch. It runs the entire length, comes down all the way to the back southerly end of the property, and then cuts across and goes through a culvert underneath the railroad tracks at the end of Dustin Road. And originally that drainage ditch was probably 3 or 4 feet wide. Unfortunately, over the decades, it was not maintained by the town or anyone else. Consequently, there was a lot of sand, silt, junk that came in off of Lowell Street, noxious weeds, the culvert got clogged up, the water backed up, created a lot of flooding and spreading of the water. So instead of having a 3 to 4 foot drainage ditch, we now have what we're living with today, and we're dealing with conservation, what are considered wetlands. So unfortunately, we have to deal with that. Those issues will be dealt with in conservation. Our proposal is to do a lot of the cleaning, get rid of the noxious weeds. There's so many weeds in there that are choking out the good plants, the healthy native plants. And also, we're offering to clean out that culvert to allow for the better flow of the water and make that property, not flooding into the backyards of Plymouth Road, which happens oftentimes in the spring with heavy rains or snow melt. Coming back around where I left off on the front door, originally we were thinking about putting the front door of this existing house, which is in here. It's a little hard to see, but the existing house is here, fronting Lowell Street. And there's about a 46-foot setback on Lowell Street, so that certainly complies. If, as was thought, we switch the front door to the new street, it is less than 20 feet, so therefore we'd end up before the Zoning Board of Appeals. We may very well just leave the front door where it is and leave the address on Lowell Street, and that way we won't have to deal with variances for the setback requirements on the front or the side, because that complies. A new garage is proposed to be built, and this road here is actually compacted gravel. I'm not sure where that came from. We think perhaps when Lowell Street was repaved, much of that might have been brought in and tamped down. We don't really know. But there's a lot of gravel, and our proposal, even by building this garage here, removing all this gravel, and there's a driveway that comes down and around and goes underneath. There's a one-car garage underneath the old house that would all be removed and seeded and planted. And by that, we actually would be reducing the amount of impervious cover over that property. So there would be a lot of mitigation down, which would improve the land itself. I can tell you right now that in addition to the long laundry list from engineering, which Thad is working very closely with engineering to comply with, our biggest sticking point right now is with the requirement from the fire chief for the radius for the turnaround for emergency equipment. And we don't have an answer for that yet. We are working, we've met with the chief a number of times, we're making different proposals. That was one of our requests for waivers in the original petition. It is certainly less than the 45 feet. We had proposed a sidewalk on one side, because there's really no need for a sidewalk on the other side. That's all wetlands.
and that would increase the road surface. We had made certain suggestions to be able to allow the fire trucks and emergency equipment to make its turn. The chief really would like to see that 45-foot radius. We're still working to try to resolve that. If we can't resolve that issue, we're going to have to go back to the drawing board, because we don't know that if that issue isn't resolved, we may lose a lot, because we just can't make that radius turn.
Mm-hmm.
So, although there are a number of other requests, the biggest one that we will have to deal with, no matter how many lots we are ultimately seeking, is the width of the road in. And we are absolutely limited by the fact that the house on the westerly side of this road, there was a curb cut there, it's already existing. This is the home of the Kiley's, and we only have 40 feet. We only have 40 feet to work with. So we have the house, we can't go any further. We can't make it any wider. And frankly, I don't think it would look good any wider, quite honestly. But that is one of the waivers that we would request from this commission. I don't know if it makes a lot of sense at this point to go through the other list right now.
I agree, yeah.
Because we have so many other issues that we will be dealing with, many of which will be resolved by the time we do that. And we should know, I hope reasonably soon, whether or not we're going to be able to work something out with fire department.
Okay.
Any specific questions or general questions that the commission may have? And we have Pat here to answer it.
Is that what you wanted to cover in your...
I think that's about...
Yeah, no, that's fine. Just wanted to see where we were.
I don't know what benefit we would get from
right.
going further, because we'd end up repeating ourselves again.
Yep, I agree. Any questions or comments from the board?
Yeah. What's the constraint on the southwest of the cul-de-sac that keeps you from enlarging that diameter? You're already at the edge there?
Yes.
So.
Sometime in the near future, I couldn't say exactly when, we will be submitting a notice of intent for conservation. I'd like to see if we can get that going sometime soon so we can further this discussion. The last time we were there, which was a couple of years ago, it was a difficult discussion about what we could do beyond those bounds, the 25-foot and 35-foot zones. And it really, really hamstrung us.
Can you show us on the map where the boundary is?
There are two boundaries.
Yep.
There's one you can kind of lightly see in here. That's a 25-foot no disturb.
Yeah.
And this one you can see in here is 35-foot no build. Just as a to kind of help out, get a better idea of the site itself.
Do you think you'll have permission to work in there?
The existing dense pack roadway in here is already within that area. So we're just basically working within an area that's already disturbed. So that we get it, that was the intent here, was that we weren't increasing any of the disturbance within that, other than the reconstruction of the roadway. So we have to apply for conservation. We get it, we don't. So it's something we have to look at.
And is the southern edge of, just off the road where there is this sort of a line of vegetation that's shown beyond the trees, south of the trees, is that really densely wooded there?
It's, there actually are some nice sized pines there, but there's also a lot of brush. And we do have a tree location plan that's within the package that shows you all the trees that we're located.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what conservation's going to say, but when I look at that, I think that the trees on the bottom curve are wasteful. Where if you're allowed to build in that, why couldn't you get rid of those trees, let the existing vegetation stay, and then do some sort of impervious surface that and that allows the trucks to turn around?
There are a number of options that we have, and we're working with the fire department, you know, to look at that. But right now, I had gone. One of the things was to actually make this slightly wider and this slightly wider, because realistically, the radius is only short in this short distance. The fire truck actually has room to make the turn, but it's not, doesn't conform to the standard, and that's what he wants us to do, is to conform to the standard. So, and that's what we have to do. That's what we'll probably have to do, so.
It sounds from the narrative as if this is almost an accidental man-made wetlands area.
The history of this drainage swale here, there's two courses in the history. Originally, what happened was this drainage swale came down along this property line, parallel to the MBTA tracks and through their culvert. Along, whenever it happens, I think in the 50s, the town came in and they installed a sewer line. There was also a gas line installed there. What happened was when they installed that sewer line, the gas line, the connection, the hydraulic connection from this drainage swale to this was severed. You'll literally go down there, you'll see an earth berm that contains the gas and the sewer line. And what they did is they created another connection. Instead of creating it here, they created it here. You'll also notice there'll be a pile of a mound of dirt here and a mound of dirt here. And what happened was it flows through a drainage ditch to a concrete culvert. It's a 15-inch RCP. And if you were out there, you could easily miss it. When we were out there and we just unclogged it just with hands and shovels, you could literally see the water go foom. You could hear it moving. But to be fair, the drainage ditches filled with a lot of leaves and a lot of debris, so it basically fills up fairly quickly. There's also a large area here that has been a lot of debris, organic matter, has been dumped here, which also severs the hydraulic connection for the water flowing this way. So that debris also leaves and so forth get into this swale and also basically clog the pipe. The area up here where the Route 129 drainage discharges, when you go out there, you'll see a large area of sand. Obviously, we don't sand it, the town doesn't sand anymore. But one of the things that we were working with the Conservation Commission on, within the limits of what we can do under the permitting of conservation, was to go in and clean this up. We can walk the swale, and there's a tremendous, overwhelming amount of trash and debris that we can remove. And we can also clean and jet that pipe, this pipe here that's clogged, clean out some of the leaves here, and we can put a control structure on it so that just in case, let's just say it gets clogged, it'll have an emergency overflow, so at some point it will keep flowing. It won't be totally clogged. Mm-hmm. Those are things that, you know, we're working with the engineering department on, and hopefully we will get permission from the Conservation Commission to do that, but I can't guarantee that that will happen.
Chicken and egg.
All right. Any other questions at this time?
The current proposal is for the three new houses, total four lots?
Yes. And can you describe again the work that's going to be done on the existing house?
Well, the old house, perhaps David might want to speak to that, but the old house structurally is pretty sound. It's got good bones.
Yep.
And so that house would be completely renovated and a garage approximately, what, 24 by 30?
Yep. No, 24 by 24.
24 by 24 garage, two-story garage would be built off the back of it. So the whole house would be renovated, improved, and
it'd be attached.
Made looking like
yes. The garage.
It would be,
okay.
It would be an attached garage. Yes.
Got it. Okay.
All right. So, this is a little strange because usually we're a little further along. I realize it's a public hearing. I definitely, public neighbor input is really important. However, I want to be careful here because the project could change significantly between what we're seeing now and what we see in the next time you're before us. So with that said, are there any burning questions, comments at this time, knowing that the plan could change significantly? Sir?
Yeah, Chris Nolte, 35 Plymouth Road. I was under my understanding that the land behind, between Plymouth and Dustin, was actually Aquifer Protection Act for the wetlands. Do you know if that's true or not?
Yes. The whole site is Aquifer Protection Act.
It is, okay.
Yes.
It is. So that adds another set of elements to it as well. Ma'am?
I guess I have more of a comment. Anna Nolte, I live on Plymouth Road, so we've sat through hours and hours of meetings, and I know that conservation, has chorusing frogs on the property. They basically said at the last meeting if they were to vote, there's no way they would approve the third house. And then the developers came back with, well, I guess we'll just have to do 40B. So my comment is, I don't appreciate that as a Reading resident. It feels like they're doing that to hold a gun to our heads. I don't know how the other neighbors feel, but I didn't appreciate it.
Okay, thank you.
And we like the weeds, Kathy Tanning, on 33 Plymouth Road. I don't want them to come down and clean out that. To us, that's beautiful nature. We haven't been, I've been there for 30 years. We haven't been able to add two inches of soil to our property because it would upset the wetlands. And it just burns me that they can come down and cut down every tree and then, oh, they're gonna plant a few things and clean up our wetlands. We don't want it cleaned up. It's perfect the way it is.
Okay, thank you.
I'm sorry, where are you on that? Are you adjacent to the property?
I'm on Plymouth Road.
Where's that?
Yeah, second from the end.
Okay. I'd like to hear if people are having flooding problems from that to understand what the drainage issues are with the area.
Hi, I'm Melissa Russell, 23 Plymouth Road. We have not had flooding issues at our house. The reason we don't have flooding issues is because we have water behind the house. We have water in the wetlands that swells when it rains and catches the water that would be in our basement otherwise. So the idea that they're going to fix something,
it's not broken.
Let's leave it as it is, please.
I agree. We don't have water in our basement either.
It does creep up onto the grasses.
Yeah.
And into our driveway, like it will seep in to the low points. Like I said, we haven't been allowed to add any soil. I don't know what happened. I don't know what's changed in the last so many years, but we've had people move off our street that couldn't do certain types of renovation projects. When we went to put irrigation in, we had to jump through hoops and have special meetings and put crushed rocks all over
yeah.
our front yard. They're gonna come down and plow up a street?
I think what you're describing also, that's recently changed, right? A lot of those regulations around aquifer protection. So I understand what you're saying. Aquifer adds, like I said, another set of elements, but this board revised those to make them a little less stringent based on a lot of feedback from folks that live in that district.
Yeah.
So it's not as complex as it used to be.
And I know the people on the other side of Dustin Road get water, right?
And they don't have the water.
We have the original.
I'm sorry, your name and address?
Barbara Crosby, and we're at 16 Dustin Road. We have the original house from Dustin Road, but we don't get water. However, across the street, they have some pumps that have the fire department pump them out. There's been that 100-year water thing.
Sure.
But there's at least three houses across the street from us that have some pumps because they have too much water.
I'm sorry, which street are you on?
Dustin Road.
Dustin Road, okay.
So that house in the middle butts right up to our back property.
Got it.
And can I just point out that the houses that have water are on the opposite side of the street, not abutting the property, and they have people behind them. So we have that wetlands behind us, and we're thinking, once you cut down all the trees, put in roads, where's that water going? It's coming into my basement.
In one of the plans, they kept saying they're gonna put water gardens in, which is a lovely idea, but to me, water gardens is putting more water back into the dirt. And where is it going? If you take down all the old growth trees, somebody is gonna get water from that somewhere.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Cindy.
Ma'am, yep.
From Plymouth Road, 17. And you say that plan may change. However, this was the original plan from the first time they went to conservation.
We've been through hours.
And then we had another plan that we went through conservation before the 40B. So how's it gonna change again?
I mean.
And I also say conservation has asked.
Hold on. Guys, folks, we gotta slow down, one second. There's a list of questions and concerns from the engineering department that could draw, here it is. So 1, 2, 3, 4 sheets of questions and concerns that they have. So that will drive a number of changes to this. And we're not gonna approve anything until engineering has stamped it. And we're absolutely not gonna approve anything unless the fire department is okay with it as well.
There's a couple of things that go on with developments that you can count on. Conservation almost always wins. Salamanders almost always win. And water management almost always wins. So somebody could put up the ugliest house next to you, but if engineering isn't happy with the way the water management is, and it has to meet some pretty strict guidelines, it won't get approved. So when we talk about low impact development, things like rain gardens, somebody has tested that to make sure that it can infiltrate in the soil, that it will move water. And being in the aquifer protection district, it looks like these all have water management systems in their lots as well, if they were to go through, to capture some of that water. So those kind of things you can't get around. Just to put your mind at ease a little bit. I'm not saying that any of this is gonna get approved. Conservation always has last say, more power than we do to control these things, but if they're not happy with it, and if engineering isn't happy with the way the water's being controlled, it won't get approved.
So who hasn't spoken? Have you spoken, ma'am? In the back, yeah, please.
I'm Julie O'Brien, I'm on Plymouth Road, and one of the questions I brought up in several meetings ago was about snow removal, and I don't know if that's on the engineering's list.
That would probably fall
on
this board.
That they hadn't thought of before, but where is all that snow going to get dumped? Because you know it's going to get dumped in whatever is free on that little cul-de-sac.
Yeah.
It's going to probably be treated.
Yeah.
Where is that chemical is going to go and everything? And where's all that? If you have a 100-year, inch storm, or inch year, I should say, that snow is going to be significant.
Yeah, so I would definitely say that if that has not been considered, we should absolutely be considering that in the plan.
Yeah, and that's
okay.
Really an issue for engineering and conservation.
Okay, good, good.
To do consideration.
Yep.
And we have and we will continue to address that.
Okay, good, good. Ma'am?
Yeah, hi. I was just, are you privy to the comments from conservation from the previous hearings, or is it something that starts up fresh every time they make a new, they re-present the same plan?
I'm personally not privy to what happened with conservation the last go around.
Because a lot of these concerns have
been I'm sure,
discussed.
Yeah. And these, I mean, we would want to make sure that conservation has had their input incorporated. So again, you know, there's like four gatekeepers here. You got conservation, you've got the fire department, you've got the engineering department, and you've got us. And everybody has to have their piece satisfied. Ultimately, we're gonna either approve or not approve the subdivision plan, but there's a lot of other players involved that need to make that need to have their issues satisfied. Sir?
Yes, Mike Hansen, 17 Plymouth Road. I don't know if any of you have actually been to the site, but it's you might want to go visit it. It's kind of a shame to see these natural habitats in Reading going away. And if you go there, you'll realize what it is, and all the nice trees and the wildlife, and that's all going to go away if you allow this. And I think a lot of it's gone away in Reading. It's a shame to see it.
Thank you. Yep. Ma'am?
Quick comment, too. I think a lot of us actually are from Reading. Mm-hmm. Stayed in town. Our towns, we really all live here, have our own homes. I want to just point that out, too, that when Mike is talking about that, we speak from experience, because we've been here for quite a few years. What consideration does the board give to how these properties will scale in comparison to the rest of the neighborhood and not scale?
As far as the size and square footage?
Mm-hmm. I mean, if they propose lots that comply with the underlying zoning district and then they maintain structures that are within the required setbacks of those zoning districts, that's really all the control that we have over size.
Ma'am?
Paula Boyle, formerly 27 Plymouth Road. Just a comment for the board, if you will. It seems to me as though the number of waivers for this project seem exorbitant. I could see one or two, but just if we take that into consideration, it just seems as though you have rules and regulations and the proponent has asked to waive
mm-hmm.
a good number of them, 8 to 10 at least.
Yeah. Has not gone unnoticed.
Thanks.
So thank you. All right, let's do one more question. Two more, because I saw somebody over here as well. So you go ahead, sir.
Frank Kiley, 370 Wall Street, on the front lot going into the subdivision.
Okay. Yeah.
One of my questions to you, this is supposed to be, at one point there was supposed to be a paper street, and if you go to the Board of Assessors and ask them what the Jamesons were paying, what they're paying taxes on, it was two parcels of land, from what they're telling me at the Board of Assessors. They weren't paying taxes on the paper street right-of-ways. So behind my house, there's a lot, 188 feet, there's a granite post, and that's where the 40-foot easement was that would have headed towards Dustin Road, off the road that's going in. My question is, How can they put the house number 2 in the middle of a 40-foot easement that they're not paying taxes on?
Yeah.
The property is all taxed. There's no exception out for what is an accessible path or roadway.
All right.
The property is all being taxed and all taxes are being paid.
Understood. And I don't think that really falls in our court necessarily.
No, but it's information that's accurate or wrong.
Right. Well, okay. All right, one more question. Ma'am, did you have a question or comment?
I'm going to comment after his. If it truly isn't, the taxes aren't being paid on that lot, then it does kind of fall into your jurisdiction that you can't allow him to put a house there.
So I think that
truly taking care of.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I'm sure that if there are taxes owed on this property, the town will collect them. That's the other thing, by the way, besides the salamanders, is that the town will come get their taxes.
Yep.
We have course.
Okay, so I appreciate everyone's feedback, input, comments, questions. I think that's probably enough, given the fact that, again, we will probably be meeting again discussing this. So we're not going to close the public hearing. We'll keep it open for now, but I think we'll adjourn this topic and revisit it do we need to, do we want to reschedule that now, figure out a date?
Is there a, an action deadline?
135 days, so we're not up against the deadline yet.
Okay.
The July 11th meeting is full.
Okay.
So that's not a possibility.
So what's that, oh yeah, because we got the public hearings.
July 25th, which is getting full, but I don't know if they would even be ready, I mean, I.
And the meeting after that would be August?
8th.
8th.
Yes.
August 8th? July 25th or August 8th?
July 25th.
Right.
If there's room.
Should we request an extension? What do we have on the 25th? Like any, we don't have any public hearings, we do?
Yes, the second public hearing.
I'm not making the 25th meeting, so you need four? Three, okay.
Let's do the 8th, if you'd be okay with that.
Yeah, that's fine.
We've got some zoning bylaw public hearings coming up, and those are wild cards. We don't know how much feedback we might get, so. Rather than keep us here until midnight, let's do that. Be okay with that?
Move that the CPDC continue the public hearing for the Lyle Estates subdivision until August 8th at 7:30?
I think the 7:30, that'd be fine, yeah.
Okay. All those in favor? Thank you, everybody. And if you didn't sign in, please make sure you sign in the back.
It's a little bit different than any of these ones, but.
All right, let's let everybody clear out and then we'll get started. Do you want to take a?
Donut break.
Yeah, you want to take a 2-minute donut break?
That sounds like a bunch of cops.
Should I hold on?
Yeah.
I mean, is there?
Possibly could be still pending.
Green light.
They issue what's called a letter of eligibility. That's when the state says yes.
Because I would expect that John Waters and, is it Sem? Semite?
Jem.
Jem? Okay, Jem.
I just incorporated your comments from the last meeting. And then the minor amendments one has some red lines on it because I received some feedback over email from some of you since the last meeting.
That's this.
Yeah.
Okay.
The the definition.
Yeah.
I thought so too.
Thanks.
They add about 4 pages to the length of
well,
the
we
bylaw.
Could,
but
we could we could put them in columns so that the definition is on the left and the graphic is on the right. If we want to try and reduce it, that might help a little bit. But I was just kind of moving quickly.
For the downtown smart growth district.
You guys have put so much time into this. Really good stuff.
Yeah.
And the reason this one looks totally clean is because it used to have a lot of comments on it, and then we went through and worked through a lot of the comments, and then my goal was to get it into a draft that looked more final for when we meet with the Board of Selectmen and the business community. I don't know if that's the format they're going to want to see it. And to go back and show all the changes, it's going to look totally chaotic.
So,
but.
So yeah, let's talk about the status of each of these. So the sign regulations, what's the latest update on this?
What do you mean?
Meaning is pens down, all the questions and comments from town council have been addressed?
We addressed all the ones that we felt like we could address and or agreed with. There's still, he hasn't, like, he needs to look at it again and really scrub it.
Oh, I see, okay.
But yeah, we did address most of his comments from the first time.
Okay.
So the drafts that we're finalizing, like the sign bylaw, are public hearing drafts, and then once we have the public hearing, we have town council review it one last time.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's any changes that the board incorporates as part of the public hearing, then that revised draft goes to town council, and then the final draft is what goes in the warrant for town meeting.
Okay. Tony and Nick, how are you guys feeling about it?
Tony Terrezzo, 130 John Street. Julie's done an excellent work. I mean, we put in some comments. Nick has done a lot of work, too. I've just been more of a sounding board, but it's in a state that you could actually put it out there for people to comment on.
Yeah, there's a few paragraphs that I thought were a bit wordy that we might be able to simplify.
Were they those comments you made earlier?
Yeah, I think
today.
I can't remember which.
Because I did try to incorporate all of your feedback from today.
I wish I could find it, actually, right here. So, the window signs paragraph?
I reorganized, I moved a couple of the sentences so
okay.
that, because it was jumping around between what's internal and what's external,
yeah,
so
yeah.
I just moved the external to the front and then the internal follows.
What page are you on?
12.
Should be preferred.
Actually, it's the third to last sentence where it says, or placed within the premises closer than 5 feet from any window. Shouldn't that be closer than 5 feet to any window or door?
Yes.
And the rest of it is good. The rest of it, the way you changed it, is fine.
It could even be just like within 5 feet of any window or door.
So it's within.
I think that might be better.
Yeah.
Yeah. 5 feet.
Within.
Of any window or door.
Good. Mm-hmm.
So did we change encouraged to preferred?
I don't have a preference. So whatever you want there.
Yeah.
What's in here?
Mm-hmm.
And we need to know it too, so we can make those suggestions to them. They just sometimes it's hard to figure out exactly what you're allowed.
Well, I was thinking about that with Pizza Town.
Tony?
Chairman, I'd like to point out in the definitions, and I apologize, I just reviewed it while you guys were doing an excellent job on the Lyle subdivision, whatever it's going to be called. 8.2, A-frame and sandwich boards. The last sentence, A-frame and sandwich board signs are permitted, is a regulation that you have within the definition.
Well, it's just, I don't know, I guess I just thought it made it more clear.
No, we don't do that.
But we can take it'll shorten the...
We did a lot of work and trying to slip by. It's one thing that they've been working on is moving regulation out of the definitions.
Yeah, that's fine. We can pick it up.
Yeah, so that's...
And there is another section below that talks about this, so... Yes, yeah.
And then the definition for sign area?
The bottom half of the graphics aren't updated yet.
Correct.
Sorry, seven?
Page seven.
Okay.
What do you mean?
So, if you read the definition is our, this town's definition, the way it's always been. You take a rectangle around the entire sign elements. So if the sign is jogging up and down, if you look at some of the examples, the arrowhead sign, for example, that our definition says to make a big rectangle around the triangle plus the word, and
mm-hmm.
that's your area. More like the Metroline Bank one. These are directly out of the model code, and I haven't edited them.
Oh, I see.
To
okay.
match our definition. I had them in there initially to see if we wanted to consider doing these polygon shapes, sort of like shrink wrap. You shrink wrap the elements, and that's your sign area. That'll make the signs bigger, right? Because
mm-hmm.
you're not wasting any area. It's also a discussion we had where Glenn was enforcing signs with multiple elements as one sign, and then the discussion was, at what point, when those are far enough apart, does it become two signs instead of one
mm.
big sign?
I thought it was the opposite. Glenn was deciding that they were so far apart there were two signs
mm-hmm.
and you're only allowed one.
Yeah, and I mean, it's almost self-regulating in that if you move them far enough apart, you can't get a rectangle around them to comply with the area you're allowed, and so now it's two signs. And so that's probably the number. The number is as soon as you're beyond that, what that rectangle allows. So I guess the question to you is, do we maintain the rectangle or do we go to the polygon? The rectangle results in smaller signs, I think. Because you're going to waste space on blank area. You're going to waste area on blank portions of the sign.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, because like the example was one of the fitness places that's down the street, down Main Street, came in and they had like a section a little bit tall, like a section on a higher part of the building, and then a round logo thing lower, closer to the door. And Glenn was like, "That's two signs," even though they had the same electrical. You know, the guy was arguing it was one, but they were so far apart and at different heights that they look like two.
Mm-hmm.
And so Glenn wanted the guy to move it up so that they were at least in the same plane. But like, if he did keep it down and put a rectangle around it, it would be much bigger than if he moved it up and was able to do a narrower rectangle. So I think it just needs to not be arbitrary. Because that was the thing, because Glenn was telling him to move them close together, and I was like, Glenn, you need to tell him how close you want them.
They would have to be close enough together so
right.
that when you bound them by a rectangle, the area is within the limits you're allowed.
Right.
And so if they're like this, and you can get a rectangle around the whole thing, and that's within the X square feet that you're allowed, that's okay. But if you have to bring them closer together in order to get
right.
The maximum area you're allowed, that's the rule. And so rectangle keeps the elements closer together, keeps the signs smaller, I think, than polygon. Because polygon, if you're going around the elements, you've got, you know, X square feet, you can spread it out over all of these elements.
Right. It's also like more difficult math wise from like standing at the counter trying
yes.
to like advise someone.
Yeah, he's gotta start, he's gonna get arguments about you're too far away from this letter, get closer to that letter, get closer
yeah.
to this element, whereas he can just sort of pick the farthest points and draw that rectangle.
Right.
Yeah,
easy to administer.
So I'll update the bottom half of this.
Okay, great.
To reflect that.
So let's hit the, weave in the Board of Selectmen and the business community meeting. The short Cliff Notes version of the discussion around the sign bylaw is it's really been updated to bring it into conformance with the Supreme Court ruling. Not a lot of regulations have been changed. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah,
Yeah, I mean, arguably no regulations have changed.
Yeah.
We've been careful about that.
Yeah, so it's been conformance with Supreme Court and then clarity, simplicity, all that good stuff.
If anything, we're allowing more than we did before with the temporary signs.
Temporary signs.
Things like that.
Gotcha.
And that's true in most cases. There are a couple of cases where we cut back on some of the signs. I will go with the 900 feet from a highway for the highway sign.
It was 1,800.
It was 1,800.
It went to 900.
Okay.
But does that...
Board of Selectmen meeting?
Yeah.
But does that, like, for the sake of being able to say that we didn't change anything, should we just change that back to 1,800 for now?
I would be agreeable to that.
And then if we next year change some of the things that we allow, we can change.
Yeah, this exercise has made us see some places where we can make things better, like two signs for single businesses in business A. Talked about that. We have an approach to that, right, where we basically say you can have half as big a sign, but you can have two of them.
Okay.
And since I was one of the most vocal opponents to the two signs, and I'd be in favor of that because I think it's actually less,
right,
less
intrusive.
Intrusive, right. Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's something we could push through pretty easily.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So what else, Tony?
Before
we get past, did we make a decision on the definition for the A-frame thing?
I'm taking out that.
Yeah, we're gonna get rid of that.
Okay, because I mean that sentence, which is in the definition, would fit quite nicely in your prohibited signs, comma general, section 8.4. Say that the A-frame and sandwich board signs are permitted only within Business B zoning district.
So does that go under prohibited or does that go under allowed?
I would put it under prohibited. Because it's, you know, it's only allowed in one district with a permit.
Well, it could also be under signs in Business B.
Yes, it could be.
If it's not already.
But we've been using these general areas to flag what is or isn't allowed somewhere so they know right away, right? Do we
well,
not
the general
anything?
Is supposed to mean things that are prohibited everywhere.
Everywhere. Okay.
Except for the first one.
Okay.
Which says, except by express permission of the town or as otherwise allowed. You know?
Well, yeah, I mean, I could put it there.
My recommendation to maintain consistency would be to put it as prohibited signs in each of the zoning districts, except for B, and then allow it as a allowed sign.
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense.
It's consistent.
So put it in each?
It's a prohibited sign in Business A, Industrial, Business C, and it's allowed sign in Business B.
So when we go to these public hearings,
mm-hmm.
if we start getting feedback that there should be some changes to content beyond the reading stuff that we've done, do we entertain that? Do we try to get that through? So let's say at the public hearing we hear from the Business A community that they really want their A-frame signs.
Some of them have them already.
Well, I'd say half the signs in town don't meet code.
I don't know if I want to open it up to that. This has been an exercise to bring it into conformance
mm-hmm.
with the law. And I think we need, I mean, I think maybe hear some of that feedback and take it on for a subsequent review. But, I mean, there needs to be a whole public input process around any changes we make beyond this exercise, right?
There should be.
So I would say no. I want to handle that gently, but
I think you can mention that it might be a harder sell. It's already complicated enough.
Right.
That it might be a harder sell to town meeting if we're doing anything more than just bringing this into compliance with the Supreme Court.
Oh, it's a good question, Nick, and I think it's a point I would want to raise tomorrow with the Board of Selectmen to say, you know, we're not opposed to feedback on where signs are permitted, how many signs are allowed, size of them, but we're not going to entertain it for November.
We could tell them that if we could get caught up at town meeting on a discussion about whether a sign should be 30 or 32 square feet.
Yeah.
And that could take hours.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this
yeah,
is like the first pass.
Rather public hearings first.
Yeah, first we need to get this to be approved by the
we
Attorney
need to get
General.
This.
Yeah. We need to make it legal.
Yes.
Agreed.
But are you going to be there tomorrow, Tony, at the Board of Selectmen meeting?
I had not planned on it.
Okay. No, that's fine. I mean, you guys are a lot closer to this than I am, so if questions arise, I'd like the expert, one of the experts, to be there to help
so
address it.
Expert.
Fair enough.
So
more of an expert than me.
So-called experts.
Self-appointed, whatever.
But if people are proposing substantial changes, I would say that should wait for a subsequent town meeting.
Yeah.
And each change could be one article on it. That way you're covered. Instead of the, we're going to change everything or nothing,
right.
It's
yeah.
One, two, three. Those are the changes we're going to make.
Yeah.
All
right.
Okay.
Well,
yeah.
What was our word? The word for recodification versus change.
Yeah. Reorganize without changing the meaning.
Yeah.
Any other questions on sign regulations? I think site plan review we're good on. Anything we need to know? Anything about the changes that are significant?
So I've kind of, as I've been going through them, I've kind of changed the way that I'm talking about them, because I'm feeling like adding special home occupation maybe really isn't something minor. It's like adding a use to the use table, and it's adding a section of provisions for a special permit.
And these are clean copies, just so they're easier to read. We're still going to do the track changes.
Yeah,
yeah.
I mean,
as we heard from town meeting, that track changes are crucial on anything related to zoning.
Sure, I think if you make all the versions available, the track changes version and the clean version, in case in a PDF format.
Oh, I have so many.
Yeah,
versions.
Actually, it's not track changes; it's bold and cross out.
Okay.
That's what town meeting prefers.
It's going to be an effort, but it'll be possible. I mean, because
yeah.
You can do compare.
Mm-hmm.
You can compare the documents and then have it show us the new track changes, and then we can go in and highlight and cross.
Yeah.
At least that's what I've been thinking all along that I was going to do. I hope it works.
Well, the thing is, PDF allows you to do the balloon kind of comments.
Yeah.
Which is much, much better than Microsoft Word.
But town meeting wants bold and cross out. Bold for the new language and cross out for the old language that we're.
Yeah, but I don't want
away.
Them interleaved, which is what Microsoft does.
I mean,
interleaved?
Like, cross out Word, bold, bold, cross out Word, bold, you mean?
Oh, yeah.
The word by word is impossible to interpret. What you want is you want to say, you know, old with the cross out and then new as a separate.
Bold. With the new thing highlighted.
Yeah, you might have to.
I mean, so
it's dangerous sometimes because then it looks like you're changing the entire paragraph, and so which words changed?
Well,
you have to have the interleaved version somewhere. It's more tedious to look at, but you can tell that only this word and only that word changed, and only these were deleted. It's not the entire paragraph,
right.
And now I don't know what changed. Right?
I think you need a manual process when you go through it and you make that determination. that I changed three words in this paragraph, fine, we'll cross out and bold.
And the result is.
All right, if I changed virtually everything in the paragraph, bold and new.
I agree, yeah.
Yes, but if you, that you're making a significant change at that point, that's okay.
I mean, the sign bylaw is gonna be, it's entirely different.
All right, that's what they want.
That's what they want, we heard that loud and clear.
It's gonna look totally chaotic.
It's okay, PDF of the final, PDF of the original, and then this track change, track changed version that you're talking about, bold and underline.
Bold and cross out.
So they can go back and forth if they have to.
Now, the original that you'll use, is that the original that I created from the PDF?
Or you're gonna get it from.
Or is that going to be the original from the town clerk?
We'll work that detail out. No problem.
That doesn't matter, that's a,
No problem.
That's a PDF, right?
Julie's got that.
I don't touch that one with a 10-foot pole.
We have our ways.
Answer to that question is yes.
So. More about minor, like, well, so summer minor, so in the public hearing, a legal notice that I did, I really clarified what I think is minor. And I, so I took any like additions of uses like pet grooming and home, special home occupation kind of out of the minor thing. It's like, I don't know, I have a hard time with that. And then one thing I talked to Glenn about lot shape, and he said, I don't think we should have it at all. And I said, well, then, you know, we could end up with some crazy looking lots.
Yeah.
And so he and I talked about different options, and he liked the idea of the width at the building line. So whatever the required width is in the zoning district, you have to maintain that width at the building line, so at least at the front setback line. The difficulty with that is only three districts in town have a required width.
Okay.
So I tried to build in some language that would cover.
Well, the, what you sent around, what was on the Google Drive, made perfect sense to me. But, you know, go ahead with that.
Okay.
And basically, there's two cases if there is a defined, you know, lot width, then do it, and if not, then the way you had it written up was appropriate. I mean, if somebody wants, you know, a cupcake border around the back of their property, more power to them.
Does this prevent that condition we talked about, the Concord condition, the fan-shaped lot?
It should. Because we don't even have a provision for the hammerhead, but we do have, you know, so if the lot's been in existence since prior to zoning, it has to be 50 feet at a minimum. And then if it's new, then we have the frontage requirement that's, you know, 100, 180 or 120,
whatever,
and then
whatever,
the width is only slightly less than that.
Does this work on those lots in the cul-de-sac? Does this work on lots that are on the curve?
I think actually the lots on the curve will end up being, yeah, I mean,
what about your 45
degree?
So
I have this, I have B, which says the angles formed by the intersection of the side lot lines on the right of way shall not be less than 45 degrees. I don't know.
Not less than.
Be at
than,
least
right?
45.
It should be.
Yeah, so they've got a really.
Yeah, that's a good question.
We're at a lot here. See that angle right there? I'm not sure what that is. How you measure that? I guess tangent to the curve.
Which angle?
Well, I'm looking at this particular. Image, but I mean, that's the property line, right?
Right.
So.
I mean,
That's all, we just have to make sure that
Yeah.
we're not creating something crazy. So then this would have required frontage, what would we do? We'd have to, we'd swing it around?
I mean, you could, but you wouldn't have to. I mean, we're not saying that you can only have the width of the building line, we're saying you have to at least have the width of the building line. So like they would measure that here.
Because we're saying that's the frontage fix.
This is where they're putting the house, yeah. So if they didn't show us any homes on this plan, we would look at the setback line.
Okay. We're just gonna need to explain it, that's
yeah.
all.
Yeah.
So we should know what it is.
Yeah.
And then what were you saying about about the special home occupation?
I was saying that I think we should stop referring to it as minor. So just kind of talk about it as its own, because we're adding a use.
Oh, I see what you
and
mean.
And then we're adding provisions by which you guys can grant a special permit for that use category.
That's right. So, okay.
So.
It's a zoning change rather than a minor update.
Going into the table of uses.
Right.
Right.
But it's going to be part of, so we need to kind
of
rephrase that article. That right? Because right now, what are we calling it?
Special home occupation. So,
but it's part of the minor amendments.
Well, I've stopped listing it like that. So the
yeah.
public notice doesn't list it that way. The agenda for your public hearing doesn't list it that way.
How does it list it?
As a separate.
Oh, a separate line item altogether.
Change to section 5.
Yeah, that, like I have like other changes. I have like signed bylaw, site plan review, other changes, minor amendments. Something like that.
Is this going to be a separate article?
I mean, I don't know how this town does it, but in my experience, every single thing was a separate article. So.
Yeah, I guess we never really spoke about that. Operating under the assumption we were going to have four articles or three
articles.
Okay.
We haven't really that's
all right, cool.
Town council will write the articles.
Yeah.
So he'll tell us what's
okay.
the best way of communicating that.
Got it. Perfect.
We give it all to him, and then he
right.
creates the articles.
Okay.
And it's long before the warrant closes,
yeah.
so we're not in any danger
okay.
of bumping into that.
Awesome. All right.
So did you have any comments about... I guess I should just mention really quickly that Glenn also doesn't think we should allow contractors' yards anywhere in a residential district. He thinks it's opening a big can of worms. And so... A way around that is to just sort of, you could allow like a contractor to have, and as a special home occupation, he could have like one employee and they could come pick stuff up out of the garage and go to the site. Like he doesn't think any storage of anything for a contractor should be happening outside of a permanent structure on a residential lot.
Yeah.
Which I don't really disagree with.
I agree. It's a good catch.
Well, the one case where you'll run into pushback is a snowplow.
But that's, we have a separate, you mean a plow detached from a vehicle?
Right. Sitting next to the garage for, you know, 3/4 of the year.
He said, like, he made an example. He's like, I'm okay if a homeowner has a few ladders lined up along his garage and they're not inside, but if it's like an actual contracting business and they have stuff all over the yard, like he's not okay with that. So I mean, the occasional snowplow maybe wouldn't trigger
a neighbor complaint.
So you're saying it's the parking / garaging of one commercial vehicle or the parking / garaging of more than one commercial vehicle?
Right now we allow one.
Right.
So I added the
more than one.
The more than one component.
Is that how we say it now? Parking, garaging of one commercial vehicle?
No,
seems different.
It might just be of commercial vehicles, and I clarified. Did I highlight it?
You highlighted
so
it.
So, yeah, I must have clarified it.
Well, it's currently in the table of uses. It's an accessory use.
Yep.
Is the storage of commercial building materials, equipment, or vehicles over 10,000 pounds.
Oh, I think that I must have added it.
Did I add it all?
No, you're, this is underneath that.
Yeah, so I think I added both of them, because.
These are both new, one commercial vehicle, and then more than one, those are new.
That's why there's a.
That's why they have.
I mean, maybe we don't need, if we say more than one, maybe we don't need. I guess I put one as by right. I mean, that's currently what we're doing, we're allowing people to have one, actually, we don't really have a restriction, as long as they're under 10,000 pounds. And registered and parked on pavement.
Yep.
We get calls every day. So, I was trying to clarify, but maybe we don't actually need to add that.
You're saying there's a general bylaw for that? What are those rules that you just talked about where they're parked on?
Oh, yeah, maybe that, the registration thing might be in the general bylaw. The pavement thing.
Okay, but it has to be somewhere.
Alright. So do we need, is there a question then that we need to get answered? Or are we good?
No, I just wanted to alert you to the changes that I made.
Okay.
In case.
All right. All right, so that covers us for the zoning bylaw amendments. Are there any other questions or comments on that? No, I think we're good. All right, we'll probably touch upon it when we get back to the Board of Selectmen discussion. Mr. Waters?
Oh, was that Bowley Coley?
Yeah. Excellent. All right. So we'll move to that. Appreciate your patience. Minor site plan review for Bowley Coley at 281 Main Street. Julie, anything?
So they're proposing to add a 230 square foot, I believe, entrance vestibule to the building. It's Bowley Coley Insurance on the second floor and Bay State Physical Therapy on the first floor. It's the former E-Cars building. In doing so, they are going to be doing a small amount of work inside the resource area, is that correct? And so they're proposing to remove 60 square feet of brick pavers. The site currently has like a little walkway that ends in like a little bulb. They're proposing to remove some of that bricked area to, on a 2-to-1 basis, to make up for the small amount of work in the conservation area. But we thought that you guys should review it simply because it's right on South Main Street in an area of interest. These redevelopments are can really make that part of town look nicer. So.
Good.
Also, it does trigger minor site plan review because of the way the minor site plan review threshold is worded.
Okay, and we've got also, is there the A&R?
Those are old. So a lot of the plans that were submitted were just sort of like history of what was approved.
Okay.
The new plan shows the site plan, and then it's like marked up in like, I think, red and blue ink. I'll pull it up. This one. Oh, there's that one.
Anything you'd like to add about the project?
Yeah, I might just be able to help you walk through quickly.
Sure, and just your name for the record.
Rich O'Connell with IJ O'Connell Associates down in Stoneham. We were the design engineers for E-Cars a few years ago. And so when Bowley Coley came along and wanted to put in a vestibule, they gave us a call. Elephant in the room, what's Bowley Coley stand for?
I know it.
You know, because you're at the meeting. Bank-owned life insurance, company-owned life insurance, and they do something with selling that. But
That's what boldly colon stands for. It's not a disease, it's not anything like that. So, Julie, can you pull up C2?
Yep.
From the package, I can really go through this pretty quickly.
Is it this one, CP2?
C2.
Does that look like it?
That's it.
Okay, do you want me to blow it up a little?
Sure, if you can.
Keep me over sure.
Pointer or laser?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this one right here.
Oh, okay.
Handy.
So this was the approved plan, back when we did the e-cars. This is the approved plan back when we did e-cars. Perfectos is being built next door here, and then this is actually the lot here, and there's a lot of unused land in the back here, wetlands and all of that. So anyway, Dan and John did a lot of work cleaning this up way back when e-cars didn't make it, but we built a walkway, a very wide walkway, brick walkway that came up so that they could bring the cars into the building, and that's the way the vestibule was built. It was just an open door, park the cars in there. So since that time, and there was an A&R done, you mentioned the A&R, we did an A&R in 2013. Can you flip to that one, really?
Yeah, that was just to give...
That's the PL1. Yeah, I was trying to give you a little bit
perfect of... Perfectos room for their parking area.
Exactly. So, we sold a strip. Dan and John sold a strip of land down here about 10 feet wide, and then a little chunk in the back here. And it allowed us, at that time when Perfectos was our client, to redo their parking lot. It was a little incentive by the ECAS guys to get that project moving. So the zoning summary that was on the original one, excuse me, wasn't correct, and it was never updated because we just did the A&R. So then the third sheet was a red line sheet of the bulk and dimensional from the original plan, because they sold about 3,000 square feet. And all I did here was just quickly pop in the numbers for the parking. Instead of 1,800 square feet, it's now 2,030. The basement doesn't change, although they don't use the basement. So the parking number changed from 18 to 20, and we have 19 existing striped spaces. There was no change on the ADA parking, no change on the loading spaces. The square footage did go down for the A&R, but all the bulk and dimensional were pretty much the same, except for a 10-foot side yard setback because they sold that strip of land. Then when we moved to what we're doing in 2006, I'm sorry, that 19 is actually for the new one. There's no change on the square footage from that. There is a change on the front yard setback from 48 to 35, but it still meets the requirement. No change on the side yard. No change on the side yard. I'm sorry, the change on the side yard from the A&R there is the same. No change on the rear yard. That's always been the same. There is a little bump in the lot coverage. It goes from 5.4% to 6%, and then there's no change on the maximum building height. So we met with Julie and Chuck a couple weeks ago and went through what was going on. It's about 230 square feet, two-floor vestibule. It's basically to get access to the second floor, dress up the front of the building. When it was a car dealership, they didn't need access to the second floor. It was just their offices. And that's about it. So we thought it was a minor modification. We have submitted the plans for your review, and certainly we would be open to Gene and Julie to look at the final plans before they go to the building inspector to make sure that everything's okay. That's
Thank you.
Okay.
Any questions from the board? Seems pretty straightforward.
Well, I'm just confused by this architecture, just to the point where I don't get it at all. It's just, it's an awkward building to begin with, and this addition is just slapped on there with some awkward elements that don't seem to make it cohesive. And I don't know, it's like a bad first year project. It's just really bad. I don't get it. I'll usually add some comments about architecture or design, but I understand that the owner can do whatever they want. This one's just so bad.
So, what we have, I mean, that's a block. That's really not what's going to be. That's a massive.
No, I understand. That's like a half-finished SketchUp model that someone could do in 2 minutes.
Yeah.
I see the elevations. I can read it from the elevations. I'm sorry.
I understand. That's fine. So that's why we said that. You know, we're open to Gene and Julie and the staff to review.
I mean, the model doesn't really match the elevations anyways, because the roof height of the canopy in front of the projection is lined up on the model, but not on the elevations.
Right.
Frankly, this would be better, because you could just take this and wrap it around. If you tie all of this together, at least it would look like it was somewhat cohesive. See, this is lower here. Not really showing up well. This is lower in the front. These columns are round, these are square.
Mm-hmm.
This roof slope is just silly.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It would, from a visual point of view, it would look better if the vestibule did not have that roof or the canopy in front on the first floor. If it were just, you know, a colonial leg in the middle of the building.
Yeah, but then there's no cover at the entrance, and you might be getting buzzed in. I'm not sure.
Well, I mean, it depends on where.
You know, the first person in's got to unlock the door, and they're sort of standing in the elements. I understand the need for a canopy there.
Well, with that, and what doesn't show in there is there are two entrances into the vestibule. It doesn't show on the massing model, but there is the stairway and the ADA accessible ramp that come up this way. And there's a doorway that comes into the vestibule from this side.
Doesn't meet code, by the way, that entrance.
Okay. I'm a civil engineer.
No, I understand. I'm not trying to be.
I'm not the architect. I'm not O'Sullivan. I think you guys probably have dealt with them before. That's kind of why I said, you know, this was something they put together for Boley Coley to say, this is what you could do to get a vestibule. It's certainly not a final drawing.
Okay.
Has that ramp been built? Is it there right now?
Yes.
It's not the ramp, it's the entrance, the door to get in from the ramp?
The proposed entrance, or the...
Yeah, there's a column inside the clear space in front of the door.
So you're saying that this is just an idea that you want Julie and I to finalize it?
No, this was put together for my clients by O'Sullivan Architects because they wanted to get vestibule access to the second floor for two reasons. They now use the second floor as their office, and they have a different operation on the first floor, and they only have a back entrance, interior entrance, to get to the second floor. Now you come in through the back, and then there's a set of stairs that come up to go to the office. The other part is because every time you open this door, when it was a car dealership, it didn't make a difference, but depending on the time of the year, it doesn't have the double door energy efficiency of a vestibule. So in the winter, you open the door, the wind blows in, and the summer, you open the door, and you lose all your air conditioning. They also wanted a little better presence with the building, so it does a twofold thing. It's an operational and let's make the building a little better. If you remember back when we started this, the building's kind of set, there's not much we can do with it because it is in the riverfront area. We went through lots of gyrations with Concom, excuse me, to get this approved and get the square footages. And we are before them this Wednesday night. Again, as a minor modification, because there's 30 square feet of newly impervious area, and we're going to mitigate that. But the building's kind of set. There's not much you can do. There's a brownfield site. There's a lot of different things. I'm not the architect. I do understand if you have architectural comments. That's fine. I didn't know that the board wanted to get into that detail. So what I was saying, Julie, is, Gene, is these are not final. If staff wanted to look at final before they went to the building inspector, that would be fine with us. That was just my suggestion.
Well, I don't think, I mean, it seems like the points that have been made so far on the architecture is that this needs additional work. And I don't know that, I certainly wouldn't feel comfortable weighing in on something without the board seeing it as well.
Yeah. Do we have any say really on it? I'm just letting you know my opinion.
Well, it's,
as far as the program goes, it's fine. You know, I understand what the stair is for and the vestibule is, it's a good idea to have that for energy efficiency and access.
It'll have to, Glenn will work with the code issues that you mentioned,
mm-hmm.
or he issues a building permit.
Yeah, we assume that would come at the building permit review.
Yeah.
Again, I didn't review it for code or
I mean,
review it for square footage.
But the compatibility with the neighborhood and how it fronts onto Main Street, that's, as Julie said, that's why we wanted the CPDC to understand what this design was about.
Yeah, no, I just mentioned that, Gene, because I know the first time around you got pretty involved with the architecture and how it was going to set up, so I just thought that would be in your bailiwick.
Well, it's, I mean, as the draft decision says, I mean, it does meet, I think, the it stays within the threshold of a minor site plan review.
The way that it's worded is 500 square feet of vertical or horizontal change, which, like, you know, so if someone resided their whole structure, I mean, that would end up being 500 square feet. So that's why this triggers site plan, which is,
yeah,
it's a little awkward to me, but.
Well, but it's good to have the review, but I think the minor review is reasonable for this.
Yeah, I'm not arguing that. I'm just letting
right.
you know what I thought.
I agree with you.
I guess I would add a statement or a condition that just said that we think the architect should revisit the design.
Yeah, I think we're passing hints to our implementers of the minor review.
Can we add sub-bullets underneath that finding, specific areas? You pointed out the...
It's really the look of it. I'm not having a problem with the program. The stair can be there, the way it's accessed and all that's fine. It's just the execution of the elements on the front of that building.
Now, if that's going to be a condition, then how are we going to decide that it's met?
I don't know. I'll help you if they submit something. I don't know. I don't know what our leverage is there. Again, I'm just letting you know.
Well,
what I thought.
I mean, if the staff wants to bring back the next iteration, we'd be happy to provide more opinions.
I think that's the cleanest way to do it because, you know, what we're hearing is this board wants the architect to do another, take another crack at this.
Yeah, it's basically just this because all of the site plan work makes sense.
Right.
Thank you.
Right.
Yeah. That
it's engineering, right? It's clean.
That vestibule needs to have a do-over.
Yeah, I think so.
And is that something that we could do with administratively with input from Nick? I mean,
that's another way to go. If the board is okay with that.
I'm okay with it. I'm
sure.
I just
Nick has a much better vision of
that would save them from having to come back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd be okay with that.
Okay, that makes it easy.
And so just a couple bullet points, Nick. Roof line, canopy, and doorway entrance.
I heard columns.
Yeah, it's the, I'd say, roof lines, windows. I mean, the side windows don't even line up with the bottom windows. It's kind of weird.
Probably done at sketch up. Front windows, columns. Okay, I can certainly pass that on to the client to pass on to the architect.
What else? You made a couple other comments. Like, do you want to just clarify, and then I can make sure they're written so they have the clear direction?
Sure. I would say that it doesn't look like it's integrated with the building. Front canopy
is... Well, it doesn't look... The canopy
the new addition. The addition doesn't look like it's well integrated with the building. The front canopy is sort of out on its own. The model doesn't match the elevations.
Right.
So it's unclear which one they intended. There's round columns on the new addition, and then it looks like there's square columns on the older piece. Window elements on the side, on the south side, don't line up top to bottom. That seems like a silly thing. See the left, see the bottom window on the addition on the south elevation is sort of inboard, and then the two top ones are, they don't line up. It's like something that could make it less awkward.
Do you want that as a condition? I guess it should be a condition.
Whatever we can do. Can you conditions like that?
I mean, I guess, well, if it's something that we're going to require before we sign off on their minor site plan, then it's a condition.
The condition should be that they revisit it.
Right.
I know they can do a better job.
I just don't want to get into a conflict at the counter with the architect saying that, you know, because we're questioning something, or you know that all of a sudden, you know, we're being difficult.
Well, I think there's no objection from an engineering point of view. It's we're questioning the aesthetics of the result. And if they're adamant, then they're entitled. I mean, it's just.
Well, I think what we're saying is there's going to be a new design. The three of us are going to review it. And my preference would be to have a scheduled time when the architect comes in
right.
with the plans. And we can schedule Nick with us and we go over it. Not just have him come in at the counter.
For argument one.
Yeah, we don't. Well, we want to try to avoid the conflict situation. I think it should be a formal meeting. And we'll review and discuss at that point.
That makes a lot of sense.
Are you comfortable with that? Because I realize you're speaking on behalf of your firm, your architect, and your client.
The way I understand it is this was just a quick study to show my client what could be done.
Okay.
And it's obvious to me. I'm an engineer. I'm not an architect. Thank God. But... These drawings are not developed beyond more than, can you just show me what I can do with the building?
Yeah. And we want to see stuff.
I do not think it's imposing of the board to say, can you give us the next iteration and match things up and
right.
show us another plan? I do not think that's imposing.
Yeah, it's possible they've already done that. I mean,
yeah.
His work is usually pretty good. That's why this is a weird thing.
Yeah, and you know, how much can you do for $500? I don't know. I don't know the parameters behind it. I was given the plan to put in there,
yep.
but I do not think it's an imposition for the board to say, come back and show us the next one. You know, this is your sketch, show us at a scheduled time.
Okay.
Okay.
So we'll add that as a condition.
Yeah.
And it will be approved administratively, and we can approve this tonight with that condition.
Yeah.
Are there any other comments outside the design? All right. There you go.
Is there anything in here about lighting in the conditions? There's nothing presented about lighting changes, right?
No, I would assume the vestibule will be interior lit, but
I think the soffit of the existing porch is lit with downlights.
Yes.
So if they're matching that on the new front canopy, I think that would be okay.
Yes. there is soffit lighting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think if they continued that, that would be okay.
Should we put a condition?
Yeah, the lighting,
okay.
Any new lighting will match the existing lighting.
Okay.
That way there aren't big ball sconces sort of facing up.
Right.
Wall.
Okay, so do we have something that we should vote on?
I think we do.
Okay. Move that the CPDC approve the project at 281 Main Street for a minor site plan review as amended.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Just letting you participate.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right,
thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Rich.
Okay. Next one on the agenda, certificate of appropriateness for Pizza Town at 648 Main Street. How are you? Julie, anything you want to open us up with?
So as I understand it, Jim here is looking to replace the existing Pizza Town sign, which is light blue and gold, with a sign of the same size that will be red and white. I think the letters of the proposed sign are slightly bigger than the letters that are there now. And then at some point in the future, there are three lights, right? And you want to add a fourth one and then change the fixture so it's not halogen, but it's LED instead. So they're there now, but they're halogen and they always burn out in the snow. So he wants to change them to LED, but that would be some point in the future.
Which would be included in this decision or no?
Trying to receive, what did I put?
Shall submit a lighting spec. Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I asked for the spec.
That's cool.
Just FYI, I abstain from this particular issue. Both of my sons work there.
Oh, okay. And we're good with three voting on this?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Let me just pull up some of the.
And Jim, while she's doing that, any comments you want to make regarding your application?
No, we talked with her, but we needed a change. It was so old, the sign is over there. We need to change the color too. We wanted to change not just the stretch of the sign.
So
are the letters flat?
Sorry?
Are the letters flat?
Yeah.
They're not dimensional?
No. Not to be changed, just as the metal is the same, we wanted to paint it. And then the letter is a little bigger because not the same size now. And my name is changed, not the same. Before Tom Pizza, and we buy the new one here. And after we changed it, just Pizza Tom. So I'll change it. But nobody see us because we work in the nighttime. Nighttime, very, very dark in there. We wanted to change the color maybe red is one, and white is will be nicely, will be shiny, would be nice. We want to work like this.
But the awning is not going to change? So it'll be Pizza Town up top and Town Pizza down below?
We'll try it.
I'm wondering if you fix the lighting, maybe that will, could you keep the existing sign and fix the lighting?
Yeah.
And then people would be able to see it when
yeah.
it's dark out?
We tried before, last winter was very hard, you know, the snowing. Every weekly we changed the all halogens because of boom, every night, every
mm-hmm.
night. But the light's not enough because we wanted to change the sign too, and color, and the name too. If you say yes, if you say okay. We need to change. If you say no, is it the same? We don't want to change all things the same or the same.
Well, will this, I think, I don't know if you answered Mick's question. Will this change? Are you going to change that at all? Because now they won't match.
We will cut this one, sir. We will cut this one.
You're going to get rid of that.
Yeah, we don't need this one. This light, the same. We don't change it. Just light will be lit. This one now halogen. Doesn't work.
Yeah.
And but we need to sign this color and then the name is changed. First, especially, we want to change this one. Light after, I mean, because this light, this area has a light too, inside too, but important is change the sign, if you say okay.
Yeah.
Is this red panel applied in front of the old sign, or is it going to be flush with the blue? Flat with the blue?
No.
It sticks in front?
No.
Are you going to paint over this, or are you going to put
it's,
a whole
it says
new
it's
panel,
a new panel
on top of it?
This is paint, sir. This paint. This one, we take the old leathers, this one. We will paint it all the new one. After we make the new leathers, big one for here. We will put that.
That's not what this says. This shows a new pan.
Yes. All new one.
So that shows that this is a new piece of metal.
Yes, new piece of metal.
Okay.
We tried it before, the paint, but it's not not good because it's too thin, very old metal. We can't paint it. The paint not good for in the top.
That's fine. But this red will be the same level as the blue, or will it be in front of the blue?
Yeah.
Which one?
The same. The
flat.
Size is the same. Yes, flat.
This is
this
flat.
Not the front, not the back. This is flat.
Okay.
The same. Size is the same. Everything is the same.
So it's just being painted?
No,
it's a new pan.
Yeah, new pan.
That's what this order form is for.
That's what I'm looking at, red pants.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
It's not going to be painted. It's
okay.
going to be a new red panel.
Panel.
Yes, new red
with
panel.
With new letters.
Okay.
Which doesn't conform to the size requirements.
Well, yes, technically it doesn't, but it's what's there.
Well, but the letters are bigger, so you're sort of making a non-conforming sign more.
Are the letters bigger than what we allow?
Well, they're bigger than the other ones. I mean, we're completely.
Right. The letters don't match, but I don't think they're.
Unofficial master plan of this Art Deco building is being destroyed.
Unfortunately, we don't have a master signage plan for this building.
Mm-hmm.
We have a certificate of appropriateness.
Were all those blue signs approved at once through a certificate?
No, I don't think they've ever come through. I've never seen those signs come through.
I couldn't find anything.
No. I don't think they've changed. They've been there forever. I don't think the bigger letters are better. If they were smaller, at least it would. If they were the same size, maybe that would help. I don't know. I'm going to how many do you need? You're going to abstain, right? I hate everything about this sign, but I'm not going to stop it. If he's going to cut that canopy, you're going to cut the canopy?
Yeah.
But that thing must be structurally attached to the front of that. I don't think you can cut that valence, can you?
I don't know exactly. I needed this
huh?
one.
We don't think we want that.
No, we don't want that. Cover it with something.
We tried it before only in a special papers, red one. We put that, but it is not much. And the leather is the same size, but is I can't see it in the nighttime too. I wanted a little bigger. We talked to my sign writer. He made it like little bigger.
I'd just leave it.
Leave it as is? I don't know, what can I tell you?
Just finished with the
Inappropriateness.
Is there any iteration of this that you would approve, like if it was a different color, if the letters were slightly smaller?
If the letters were smaller and they were dimensional, that would be, probably be tolerable.
If they could use the same letters and just have a different color?
No, that's not what he wants this, so I'm struggling with that.
I know, but I'm just trying to meet in the middle.
We're already red, so we've already broken the building, you know?
Well, I'm wondering though if you would allow something that's a little less red.
Did you look up any?
I did.
Any colors that may?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not taking responsibility for this if it looks terrible, but I do have some things in here that I.
Sure, can you run to Home Depot?
I did.
These aren't red.
It's, I was looking for something different, because they don't want the same.
Eighties section?
I was born in the '80s. I mean, I was just looking for something. I thought maybe the brown, the light brown color.
My pizza store is color is red everywhere inside before the red too. After we change it in a little, like orange. But outside, if it's color red, it's good for us.
Do you guys wanna see some pictures I took today?
Sure.
Red letters.
So, that picture actually makes the sign look darker blue than it really is. The lighting isn't great, but.
Yeah, they're faded signs for sure.
I mean, I was wondering if he could carry through some element on the building, like the Good Hearts font or the color or something, like would.
Well, that's why I was thinking the font size. He can do all caps because the other ones are larger initial letter, right? But if he did all caps, but they were just a little bit smaller.
Right.
Then it would at least flow across there. I guess I forgot that the Good Heart sign was different than the other two.
So these two are the same building, they're just different signs. And then you have the unfortunate thing about this is that there's no break in the building between Sims Jewelers and Tom Pizza, like there is with like here between Children's Shop and even between these two. So it's like, it's gonna be really obvious, the change. I guess that's what they want.
What about the white with the red letters?
Well, yeah,
that's
I was
what you just said. I think that's an interesting idea.
If they could use this same kind of tone here and
is that purple?
It's like light pink, very, very
pink.
Light pink, I think.
Pink, but it's so dirty now. Before I saw the color in the picture, it's not the same color. Very, very light before, like the white.
Oh, that's great detail. Halo, just some nice halo letters. Perfect.
What are you from the 80s?
Where's our stupid facade program again?
That went out of business.
Yeah. Got one good building to put down.
Jim, have you ever considered a sign that projects out from the building so that if you're walking down the sidewalk, you can read it, you can see it?
I can't see.
So it would be like this, from the building.
So.
Try this one, but
Orange Leaf and Diamici's has it.
Different. So.
Like you could, if you kept the sign that you have now, but then added a sign sticking out, so then you would have two signs, but you'd have one that people could see more easily if they're walking down the street or driving.
You don't want to change too big thing, but the letter, I don't know. Well, I want to talk to my sign writer too.
How big do we think these letters are?
I think
that
picture
you had of it up there, was that to scale? This is to scale, that's, let's see. Yeah, I guess that's about right.
That is so big.
I think that would look kind of cool, having a blade sign stick off. Red with the white letters.
The blade sign would look cool, but is he going to... You gonna do that in addition to this?
No.
Or
no.
Instead of
I think
this?
It would be well. Instead.
I think it'd be one or the other. You'd get a second sign.
Yeah.
And and it would be a blade sign.
And then it would, they'd have to be careful where they put it because they have that tree.
We have only one sign.
This picture was taken before the tree started blooming, but they have that tree. It's like right in the way of all the, it is kind of hard to see the sign, the tree. So the blade sign would have to be strategically,
it would have to be
so that if you're driving, you might be able to see it.
Mm. Oh, the CVS building's right there, huh?
Well, and the CVS is red.
Yes, this one red. There's different kinds, different color. And there's other Chinese food, different color too. Middlesex Animal Hospital is red one. And
different building, though.
Yes. But there's two next to it together.
But this is one building.
Yeah. But it's a different store. We wanted to change it because we are not the same store. Nobody understanding. Still, this building, maybe 40, 50 years here, every people come in the store, oh, when you open, is this pizza store? Nobody knows. 25 years, maybe 40 years, every people living here, nobody knows pizza store. I freak out some of the time because we talk, oh, the same only Chevrolet owns. We don't know, see, we can't see before. Oh, when you open it, nobody knows. I want to know when people doesn't know now. We need to work, we need to job here. We want an advisor.
Yeah, wind flag.
But nobody knows.
Need a feather flag.
Flag?
Grand opening after 4 years.
Grand opening.
What if they put something, what if they built something here to break the signs up?
And do what? Just so you can have a different color?
Just so there's a break and it doesn't just go straight from blue to red.
Oh, yeah, well, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I'm fine. I would just go with a smaller
we have
letter.
The
I think a 12-inch
like
letter.
Pictures, too many times.
The letters are very crowded together.
Yeah.
So I think
yeah.
if you went with a 12-inch letter, these are 15 inches high. If you went with a 12-inch letter, you could space them apart a little bit and get some distinction between each letter. It'd be easier to read.
It would be kind of more like what's there now, except they would be white and...
Yeah, and then they would stand out, so...
Yeah.
And with the awning, with this...
Either remove the whole thing or leave it. Don't cut this off.
Just cover the town part.
We take this one only, this front side. That's
just
it. You don't touch the whole umbrella.
I don't know though. I think that
so old. When you open it, oh my God, all fabrics.
Can you just take the whole thing down?
No, we don't want to touch. I don't want to touch this.
Just leave it.
We just,
like, just
take this one.
Back.
We put a new one, madam.
Sign
here.
So
we want it like this one.
And then this. Are you doing anything with this?
No.
I think 12-inch letter.
Yes. We
and
take
start
just
and stop
some piece
at the same
on deli
spot.
Because
and
it's not
spread
my
the
name.
Out a little bit.
Right.
It would read
we take
letter.
This
it's
one.
It's kind of muddy.
This
one.
What
about white brown red letters?
That's it.
If he's willing to
yeah.
do that.
Because
I think
my
really
neighbor wants to cut this one too, but he said it's old, no name here, no problem.
Does
because
that look too generic
this one,
though?
Does
just look like
here,
a white?
Pizza town is
like
not
red,
not
red,
good.
Background.
It's
like
this.
It.
I just
the other two stars on that
this,
light
pink
white.
It could end up looking kind of sloppy.
Pink,
yeah.
though.
We will make new one,
like
too. But
too.
We want to color it red, too, the same. But this is too red in the front side. I don't want red everywhere.
Okay.
We don't want to change the umbrella. Just we need to change the name, too. But we can't. Maybe we make it a new one, but not now. After, if you say you will make it, okay, I will.
Maybe we have a
no.
Because we don't want to touch if you say no. If
you should
say
cover
yes.
the word town, then. That's not.
Blue tape. I can do is paint it.
I mean, that's
it's worse.
Yeah.
Is it? Okay. Well,
have
I
you
guess then.
Have you already changed the business name on all your other business materials?
Yeah.
I mean, if it's not the name of his business, that's not the name of his business. I just don't want it to be. I mean, I'm envisioning, I don't want you to cut it because I think that'll end up looking kind of sloppy in the front.
If there's a problem, there's an umbrella. I will change the new one. I will put the new one too, the same color. But we don't want the name here.
Sure, sure.
This is not a big problem. Just in the sign, this sign metal is very, very old, very, very dirty. If you see inside, oh my God, too many, there's a hole. You can't see the front side, but inside, too dirty, too many. I want to change it because
okay.
It's not good.
Is there anything
you can see the inside of that sign?
Sorry?
You can see the back side of that sign from inside?
Yes, because there's lights in this one, sir.
Yeah.
There's a stairs inside. We go up. After we see the back side too old, too many stuff, dirty stuff, I don't know where. Because nobody touched maybe 4 years. We talked before his owner, I called him. He said, oh, don't touch, it's very dirty, very blah blah. Nobody touched anywhere inside.
Well, if we're going to go with this, then I would just suggest using a 12-inch letter.
Okay.
Or no smaller than the existing capital letter, but I think that's 12 inches.
And the color is?
The color is what he wants.
And there's nothing in here about the awning, and it sounds like it may still be up in the air as far as what happens.
Well, we allow the awning, and we even allow letters of a certain size on the awning, so if he swaps it out,
he can have a 4-inch by 36-inch writing on it.
Well, that's the name.
No, we can do it now. 4-inch?
Four-inch.
There's a bunch of them, by the way. I was reading them to tell you what's happening inside.
Okay, since should we?
We need to word it that way, mark it, and then you need to stamp it.
Okay. So, color, you're allowing the red color.
So, did you hear what we're saying about the size of the letters? We want them to be a little bit smaller. We want them to match the size of
okay,
Sims
sir.
Jewelers.
Just a big problem.
Okay.
Yes. Is a red as one and red and white? Is okay for us, and a little bit smaller, no problem for me.
Okay.
And
good.
Your landlord has approved this?
Yeah. He said that no problem. Talk to town hall. If town hall say yes, no problem for me. Nothing.
Have you talked to Sims Jewelers about this?
I talked to him. He said that if you make it, and because every people said we first go to town hall.
Yeah.
If you say yes or there. After we were told, no problem for us. Everybody said the same.
Materials are going to be what's shown. What's I didn't know if you would have any comments about that.
Well, but I can't force them to do anything.
I know.
I would rather have dimensional. I'd rather have halo letters. I think it would look great.
Really, rather have what?
Halo lighting. You know.
I don't agree. Okay.
Over this, I'd rather have the gold. The three-dimensional letters all consistent across the whole building.
Right.
So I'm working my way down.
Okay.
Would the idea of the red background with the gold letters to match, would that be something you'd think about?
But it's gold, not food color. Yes, you're right. I understand you. But the red and white every time is food color. Because it's shiny. If you see the red, you are hungry. This is very important, yes, for the food sections. I'm sorry. Yes, you're right. This, we tried before I painted because pizza and last A. I tried the gold, but this is not gold. This is all plastic, leather, and gold. I can't try it. I don't like to. But white is a different color for us.
The other comment I had to do with the window signs.
I will take the old things. This one, this right, this signs, I will take the old things because this is enough the size for me. And we put the light after if you fix it, this one. This is enough. This very, very old and letters, we will clean it, old things. We don't need this too many here.
So I think it's just a point that we want the the window signs to conform
Yeah.
to what zoning allows, and I don't know that they do right now.
We don't
You can
need
only
to
cover a certain portion of the window, a third.
If I need after time, but not now.
He's not gonna be able to figure out the dimensional criteria for the window sign, so we either have to tell him
yeah.
or get
Maybe
him something.
We can tell him to take down that one that's taped up in
yeah.
the window.
Yeah.
Then
yeah, that's
yeah,
good.
So that the red and white sign that you have in the window,
this
the
one.
Large cheese pizza,
yes.
can you take that off?
Yeah, now we need that. This very special
okay.
deal for
okay.
us.
I'll try to explain it to you.
Sure.
So, you know, it's
happening,
right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so there are rules for how big this sign can be.
Yes, sir.
You can only cover a certain percentage of that piece of glass.
Yes, sir.
Right? So what is it? It's
30%.
No more than 30, no more than one third.
Said, yes.
So actually that is about a third, but because
this
you
is
have
bigger.
These,
this is bigger too. Yes. We will take
this
it.
This has
all
to be by itself.
On
yes.
its own.
This has to be by itself. This is correct.
Yes.
But both of these in this one panel don't work, right?
Correct.
Okay.
So you can keep this one, but not that one, or the other way around.
We will take this one, the delivery, and this
right.
one, and we have
clean,
the right
clean
here
up
too.
How this is taped on with tape or something. Put this on nicer.
Okay, and we have this right here, the Tom Pizza Reading Deli. You can see now.
Yeah.
We have two more leather here. We will clean all things.
This is too much.
Yes.
Only one third.
Yes, mm-hmm. we need only this sign.
Okay.
That's it.
Okay. Okay.
Window signage shall conform and condition.
And I've got that in this as well.
And then you got the 12-inch letters on the next page.
Yep. Here and then there.
Excellent. Okay.
Anything else? Oh no, you that's right.
So the awning staying blue.
Yes. Yeah.
The form says external LED lights. I thought they were halogens.
They're currently halogens. He wants to replace them with LEDs.
Okay.
And so unless you guys have a problem with me looking at a spec and saying it's all right.
No.
The lights that are there now, they already aim up.
We use only winter night time, and then after the 7 o'clock. Before, this summertime, we don't need the light. Every the time is 9 o'clock, everywhere dark. We don't need. But
right.
winter time, 5, 4:30,
sure.
everywhere dark, we need the light this time, on the winter time.
Yep. Okay.
What's the name of the sign company?
Sign company is Falcon Graphic, as in Watertown.
Was this the application was prepared by Mehmet
yes,
from
ma'am.
Falcon Graphics?
Yes,
okay.
Falcon Graphics, ma'am. He signed before, but I don't remember.
And they know they have to get a permit from the building inspector
sure.
and an electrical permit.
Sure.
And that's in here, too, as a condition.
Yep.
All right.
Okay. Are you ready for a motion? Move that the CPDC approve the certificate of appropriateness for 648 Main Street, Pizza Town, as amended.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Abstain?
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
So I'll finish the decision, the approval, and then if you can come into town hall
okay.
Tomorrow or the next day,
okay, no
it'll
problem.
Be ready for
tomorrow.
You. Okay?
Thank you so much for all things. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
9 o'clock. Let's skip minutes tonight. The new zoning legislation, can that wait?
Yeah, that's, I was just an informational thing for you guys. We don't need to talk about it.
Okay, let's talk about quickly the Board of Selectmen and the business community meetings coming up.
The easy part is they're both on Tuesday nights. Tomorrow, Board of Selectmen, next Tuesday at the Reading Cooperative Bank. Yes. And so tomorrow night is a joint meeting with the Board of Selectmen at the Board of Selectmen meeting. And it's an opportunity for more or less a check-in with the Board of Selectmen on the zoning amendments that we've been working on, I think, since January. Just to bring them up to speed and let them know the results of what was heard at the April 11th public forum, to have them have an opportunity to weigh in on the discussion that we've had about downtown zoning and the time frame of what that might look like. I've had some preliminary conversations with at least one member of the Board of Selectmen, and that member wanted me to make sure I mentioned tonight that the Board of Selectmen is very much interested in the downtown zoning and having an opportunity for some more public dialogue, possibly a meeting this summer, as a follow-up to the April 11th public forum, so that we can kind of roll our sleeves up and dig into it a little bit more. So I'm sure that that's something we'll get into a lot more tomorrow night. I think that's the, with what's been going on in the community, with the community listening sessions around town finances, the one big issue that I think will come up tomorrow night is that the Board of Selectmen would really like to see opportunities for more economic development through zoning. And I think that's something we've all been working hard on. It's just a question of, you know, whether or not we can have that ready for November. And I think we've talked about that, and it's got some more work to it. At least one more public meeting, I think, would give us a better sense of things. And that public meeting may be framed a little bit differently than the one in April, where in April the framework around it was, what do people think we should do with downtown zoning? I would imagine that message would be turned on its side a bit and say, in light of what's going on in this town, with how we need to generate more revenue, we want to push for more mixed-use zoning, more zoning that will allow for expanded commercial opportunities, more zoning that's in line with the economic development recommendations that came out of the plan. So I think with that message and that framework, a meeting in July perhaps could be a little bit more hands-on.
So tomorrow is I'll be giving a brief presentation and a recapping the work that's been done since 2013, then talking about the four priority areas that we identified back in February, the fact that three of them are in excellent shape to go for November town meeting.
Yep.
The fourth one, we're not confident we can get in time for November because of DHCD's their service level agreement, whatever it is. They take a long time. But we'll target April for that.
Yeah, and it'll give us an opportunity for some more community dialogue as well.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yep.
We could rush this through, and maybe with a wing and a prayer, DHCD might approve it, but we've learned the hard way that anytime we rush something through, it comes back to bite us. And this is such a big change that I think it needs at least one more community meeting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's also the, I think we owe the people who came to the April meeting some feedback.
Yep.
There were a lot of them.
You had 80 people?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
And we're still hanging fire, I think, on the 40B.
Yes.
Because they managed to buy up the quarter.
Yeah.
And that's certainly an influencer. might consider digging into.
So that's tomorrow night, and then we've got the business community a week from tomorrow night, which sounds like it's pretty informal. Cocktails and hors d'oeuvres, and I'll get up there and...
Liquid confidence.
Plenty of that.
God knows what Jeff will say.
I mean, I remember the previous one. I mean, it was a great opportunity, good meeting.
Good.
That one's at the bank?
That one's at the bank, and we have a similar survey that we're gonna hand out to ask the attendees to give us feedback. That worked out really well last time, too. We got a lot of feedback.
Yeah, and they're certainly stakeholders, but not necessarily property owners or residents.
Right.
I mean, so
it's a
different
group.
View. Yeah.
Yep. And we didn't even ask people to RSVP by design. We wanted it to be casual and something people could just drop into.
Yeah.
So it's supposed to be easy.
Perfect. So tomorrow night's at 8, correct? 8 o'clock for 45 minutes?
Yep.
Well, we're on the agenda at 8, right?
Right.
Yep.
Meeting starts at
7.
7, yeah.
This room. Yep, 8 o'clock is the scheduled time for the community zoning joint meeting with CPDC. And then at 8:45 is the former St. Agnes School that is presenting to the Board of Selectmen.
Right.
And then a week from tomorrow is at 5:30?
5 o'clock.
5.
Oh, boy.
5 to 6:30, in and out.
You can go back to work afterwards.
Ah, that's beautiful.
Well, it means I get to go to the bridge
after. And this Thursday, you can't forget, this Thursday.
That's right.
Oh, boy.
You don't have to be there. It's
no.
A continued hearing on Reading Village.
Do they have anything?
Do we have anything?
Do they have anything?
That's this Thursday?
Will they have anything?
Already?
We think they will have something. We have nothing.
We've seen nothing.
We've been given little, tiny little dog bones of information. Keep our tails wagging.
All right. And on that note, we good? Anything else? Any urgent updates around town that you need to share?
Nope. I'm supposed to be getting together with the T on some parking.
Yep.
We've been hammering through. There are some other remnant pieces that we're interested in.
I get asked a lot about old Walgreens. Anything?
Nothing.
But Burger King will be remodeling. I have to actually look at what they've given and see if it needs to come to you guys.
And the Perfectos is making, you know, visual prep, if you will. Have we?
Trick material last week.
The bridal shop has survived the demo delay, I think.
Yes.
We're meeting with them
Wednesday morning.
Wednesday. Yeah.
To do a pre-demo meeting.
Pre-demo. So that probably will go quickly.
Mm-hmm. Cool. And post office at Eastern looks like it's coming along. They
yep.
got their signs up and everything.
Yep.
Post office exempt from our signage?
They're exempt from everything.
Man.
They didn't even have to pull a building permit.
They just did what they want.
Did they?
No.
But electrical?
They gave us a... they threw us a bigger bone, and they let us review the plans, right?
Yeah.
The building plans. But no permit necessary.
I'm just... As long as it meets code, I don't really care.
They're exempt.
They're not exempt from killing someone. They get trapped in a room, you know, because it's an electrical fire.
Anything else?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
This went much. It's much earlier than I thought
I know.
It was going to be.
Very efficient.